Okay, good morning, everybody. Nice to see you all here today. Thank you for braving the weather and traveling from many parts of Europe to be here. It's nice to see some very old friends, and some very old friends that come along today to give talks. For example, Ken at the back there, he was involved when we started off with the CO2 refrigeration systems. He's now in Danfoss, so we appreciate all the help he provided. Of course, we appreciate the help that many of you have provided in the development of the research at Brunel University. And we have been fortunate, as part of the work we have done over the years, and of course in collaboration with many of you, to receive significant funding from the UK government to set up this centre in sustainable energy use in food chains, which involves refrigeration, of course, quite a lot. And therefore, the purpose now is to accelerate the work we do and promote it a lot better than we did in the past. And that is one of the objectives of the sort of seminar today. And of course, also promote the work we have been doing together with GEA Searle over the last couple of years in developing gas cooler technologies. And we want to sort of repeat that with sort of other areas of refrigeration technologies and HVAC sort of equipment, both on the retail side and on the manufacturing side. Now, the program for today, I'll talk a little bit about the center, about the objectives of the center. We launched the center back in September. Some of you were here when we launched it, so some of this first talk may be a repetition, but there are, of course, quite a number of new faces here today. So for the benefit of everybody, I'll highlight the objectives of the center, what we intend to do, and the facilities, and how really we can work together. Then Simon Jones from Searle will talk about gas coolers and other technologies that, and Sean Armitage will talk about gas coolers and other technologies that GEA Searle is developing. Then we have Manuel from Borg will talk about recent developments in compressor sort of technologies for transcritical CO2 systems. And then Fijado from Holland will talk about CO2 refrigeration systems in food processing and retail applications. And then we'll have, in the afternoon, after lunch, we'll have a sort of a quick lunch opportunity to network. Then we'll have Kenneth Madsen from Danfoss, will talk about new developments or future developments in CO2 refrigeration systems. And at the end, we'll talk about opportunities in a bit more detail for collaboration, new projects that we want to work on and where really we can do it together. And have opportunities for questions and answers at the end. But after each talk, we'll allow five, 10 minutes for questions and answers. So take it fairly sort of flexibly, try and finish on time at the end, but arrangements really in between, I think we can do it, can be quite flexible. Okay, so we already talked about that. We are very, very proud of this achievement of School of Engineering and Design at Brunel in terms of our sort of research impact. And of course, as Andrew said earlier, we want to work with industry really to develop new technologies and new knowledge and disseminate that. Okay. Oops, what's happening here? Okay. Okay, with regards to the center, if I can work this. It's going down. Okay, the centre is one of six centres funded by Research Council UK, in other words, the UK government supporting sort of research to make an impact on energy demand reduction in all areas of the economy. And our center really is targeting the food sector, the whole food chain. It's going back. Okay, now. I'm going to talk about, give you a bit of background, the vision and mission of the center, the objectives and the key challenges we have, the various themes, and then ways of engaging and dissemination, and how, as I said earlier, we can work together. A little bit on the environmental impacts of the food chain. Food chain is responsible for close to 200 million tons of CO2 emissions. It's about a third of the total emissions in the UK. And the food chain is also responsible for about 15 million tons of food waste, which is, if you take into account really the energy that you use to manufacture the food, so the food waste is responsible for 30 billion tons of CO2 emissions. Also, the food chain is responsible for about 367 terawatt hours of electricity consumption. That represents 18% of the total UK final energy demand. And the slide here shows you a distribution really of those emissions. Now, the objective of the center is to be a premier center for research into energy, resource use, and sustainability of the food chain with international reputation, visibility, and impact. And again, really, it's nice to see so many of you from Europe to, as I said, disseminate the objectives and of course, be able to sort of disseminate the impacts in the future. The mission of the center is to do both fundamental research into innovative technologies and approaches that will have significant impacts in the future, let's say in 10 years or 20 years, but also approaches and technologies that will have impacts in the short term. In other words, in 3 years, 4 years, in effect developing sort of technologies in collaboration with industry, that we can spend 1 year or 2 years developing the technology or improving the technology, and then that goes into the market by the company that has worked with us, or companies. The center involves three groups from different universities. Brunel University have a number of staff here, myself, Professor Kulokotroni, Dr. Kerr, and Stojeska. Then University of Manchester. Manchester University works mainly on environmental impacts, you know, determining the environmental impacts of different manufacturing processes, different transportation systems, and so on. And then we have University of Birmingham that they work mainly on food formulation, in other words, the ingredients that we put together to make different food products, how we best do that, the technologies, and their environmental impacts. And we have, at the outset, a number of organizations supporting the center, food and drink manufacturers, retailers, equipment manufacturers, and various professional institutions, knowledge transfer networks, and trade associations. And it's not an exclusive club, so with that we will be adding in sort of new companies that come along. So therefore, really, collaboration is not restricted to this. To these 33 organizations. Okay, now the objectives of the center is to first of all quantify the energy demand in the various life cycles of the chain, in other words, manufacturing, distribution, or retail and consumption. And to do that, we'll develop various simulation models to determine the energy use and the emissions. We'll be developing new technologies to reduce the energy consumption, again, for the manufacturing, distribution, and retail, and determine really ways of the food chain interacting with the energy supply system, either electricity distribution, gas distribution, and so on. In effect, you have opportunities for local power generation, using combined heat and power, tri-generation systems, more recently organic Rankine cycle systems. I mean, how really local power generation affects the energy that is required from the grid and how we can reduce maximum demand. And of course, now there are incentives in reducing maximum demand, and companies can get some money back from the electricity sort of supply companies for doing that. Okay, another objective is to identify ways of extending the shelf life of the product. Both ourselves and Birmingham will be working on that. Looking at the distribution systems, and we are particularly interested in road transport or refrigeration systems, and also understand corporate and consumer behavior, really how that behavior affects energy consumption and sort of energy reducing practices. This is the food chain. I don't need to go into that, but there are the various stages. And the center themes, we have the distribution, the production side distribution, the retail side and the consumption, and then we have the energy and resource flows, including waste. So we'll be modeling really the energy and resource flows along those stages of the food chain. Interaction of the with the energy supply system, and socioeconomic aspects and human behavior that influence the energy consumption, and as of course also food consumption. And then we have, of course, the management of the center, dissemination and impacts, and of course, today is a dissemination event. This provides a bit more detail about the areas that we'll be covering. In agriculture, we are only interested or be covering the direct energy use, for example, energy use in glass houses for heating, use perhaps anaerobic digestion to produce methane to drive combined heat and power systems or OSC systems. Food processing systems, new technologies, for example, high pressure processing, vacuum frying. One area that we are very, very interested in, we haven't done a lot of work in this area, but is microwave cooking and baking, because of the significant impact that it has to reduce energy consumption. A microwave, of course, cooking is a lot more efficient than oven. Cooking in a conventional oven, of course, you have to get the texture of the food and the appearance sort of right. So it's quite a lot of work that we can do there. And also, of course, with the microwave cooking and processing is not uniform. Particularly, we have various sort of food components in the oven. So that's very interesting for us to look at. And also, there are issues about measuring temperatures during microwave processing. Very, very difficult to measure temperatures. So we'll be looking at that. And of course, when you move into continuous processes, a microwave sort of processing, then it becomes a lot more complex. So there we're going to need sort of collaboration with staff in the school and other universities that have expertise on the microwave side. And then energy demand reduction in the manufacturing plant, process integration, energy recovery is of significant interest to us, and then fitting really the manufacturing process to existing facilities, because we don't build a large number of new facilities for food manufacturing, so we fit processes into existing facilities, and how do we best fit the process into the facility to reduce energy consumption. Food supply operations, I mean, here we have logistics, food distribution, but the main interest, particularly to the group at Brunel, is transportation in food refrigerated vehicles. So we're very, very, very interested in that, and we are looking really to formulate projects in that area. And also environmental impacts of using internet shopping as opposed to traveling to the supermarket to buy the food. We've done quite a lot of work over the years in reduction of energy consumption in food retail. There are still quite a lot of potential there, and they are very, very keen to run more projects in that area. Of course, food refrigeration cabinets, improving the performance of refrigerated cabinets. We are doing work on integrated thermal energy storage in cabinets. Predictive intelligent controls for demand reduction and the interaction here with the grid. And energy storage, the use of renewable energy sources, and again, interaction with the grid. Okay, and then energy consumption in the home and catering facilities. This involves really cooking, domestic refrigeration, and refrigeration in catering facilities. And there is an area of significant interest to us is the interaction between the HVAC systems and the refrigeration systems or display cabinets, particularly small sort of retail shops and restaurants. As I mentioned earlier, we want to quantify the energy demand and develop models that determine really what the impact will be if we change the way we manufacture, let's say, a particular food, what the impact will be on the overall energy consumption of the factory distribution and the retail side. So we model the energy flows in each stage of the food chain, the interactions with the grid, and then the whole food chain modeling and energy scenario analysis. For example, if the government changes certain policies or the retailers change the way they are doing things, what the impact will be on energy consumption and emissions. And a lot of socioeconomic sort of risk and benefits and so on that I'm not going to go into that because it will be mainly covered by our Manchester partners. Now, the scale of the center, we received £5.7 million from the research councils. The center involves 12 academic researchers, principal investigators and co-investigators, 16 postdoctoral researchers in the three universities, technician and administrative staff. We have pledges from industry of £1.3 million for past sponsoring of research students and in-kind contributions. And then the three universities pledged £4 million in staff and new facilities. And in Brunel University, we are building new facilities to accommodate the work, office space and laboratory space that's up there that will accommodate all the researchers. And you can see really the arrangement there. Have some offices there, main reception, and then space for the research students and staff, as the workshop area, small conference facilities. And then outside, then you're going to have three new test chambers to be able to do test and development work and research at control conditions, complying to ISO standards and so on. For those who came in September, perhaps I said that the facilities would be ready by early in the new year, by January. Unfortunately, all the facilities are not ready. The office space is nearly ready, we're about probably a couple of weeks away from the estates delivering the space to us. The external sort of equipment probably will take another 2 or 3 months to be ready. Of course, we have our existing facilities where we can carry on working on the projects we have at the moment. When the facilities, all the facilities will be ready, we'll find the opportunity to have another seminar or event, dissemination event, for you to be able to view the complete sort of setup. Okay, probably this slide I'll leave for later on. I mean, these projects are projects that we have been working on just before we got the large funding, but also projects that started really since we got the funding, in effect, in the last 6 months. And that will give you an idea, really, of the work that we are doing. Of course, design optimization of CO2 refrigeration system gas coolers. Simon and Sean will talk more about that in the next presentation. Energy reduction in chilled food processing facilities. This is funding from TSB. The project started on 1st of September and involves Bacavor, a large food manufacturer, and wet Waterloo Air Products. We are looking at the innovative air distribution systems in chilled food manufacturing facilities. And these are outputs that we are producing as we go along. Design optimization and control of frozen food refrigerated display cabinets. These are well-typed cabinets, and we have collaboration with one of the retailers and also users of the systems. And we are also sort of looking at integrated energy storage in refrigeration systems there. And of course, some of the other collaborators that I won't mention too many are in the audience today. We have some IP generated from there and a number of outputs. And it's an area we are very, very interested in, so really carry on working in this area. A new project funded by the European Union is superheated steam drying of food products. Again, some innovative new process. And modeling of energy flows in food chains is something that we are funding through the center entirely. Energy reduction in food retail, as I said, really we've done quite a lot of work in this area, but we are very keen to have to set up new projects working with perhaps some of you here today. Energy recovery with CO2 ORC systems. Here we have received funding from EPSRC and TSB. I'll say a bit more about this later on. Again, it's in collaboration with GEA Searle, but also we'll be looking for other collaborators to join if possible. And on the packaging side, we have a project starting, partly sponsored by Hydropack, on biopolymer, biodegradable packaging for food materials. Dissemination, we have a website, www.foodenergy.org.uk. We have setting up a network to disseminate the outputs. As I said, the event today really is a dissemination event. We're planning an international conference at the beginning of September this year. And the way we want to do this conference is that we have both academic papers and also industry. So probably going to have one of the days devoted really to sort of industry and similar to this format of today. And thanks very much.